We are talking about this today because the inflation figures that were recently released in both the US and Europe are historically high, with a CPI rising in October to 6.2% in the US, a level not seen since 1992, and 4.1% in the Eurozone. Inflation is a major topic for the markets in the coming months. The economic crisis linked to the COVID pandemic was a flash crisis. It's as if the light had been turned off and then on again, which has led to a total disorganization of the production and distribution chains. There is also a shortage of labor in certain sectors of activity. In our view, this should progressively recede. Why? Because first, there should be less demand for goods and more for services with a wider reopening of economies. This should alleviate the pressure on the demand for goods. Secondly, we should also have a normalization of the employment situation. The participation rate should increase in the coming months. And finally, the bottlenecks should gradually disappear, including commodities. We therefore expect inflation to peak soon and inflationary pressures to ease gradually as economies reopen more widely. But the major difficulty is that we do not know when and whether pricing pressure will moderate. That being said, there remains an important uncertainty. It's the uncertainty over central banks' new policy strategies and their tolerance for a sustained inflation overshoot. They could tighten sooner or later than expected by investors. When inflation results in an increase in nominal rates, it has an impact on the valuation of assets. The discount rate for cash flow increases, which results in a decrease in their current valuation. The anomaly of the current situation is that nominal rates have barely risen under the pressure of central banks' action. Real interest rates have collapsed to a 70-year low in the US at minus 4.7% instantly, and it's the same in Europe with German 10-year rates still largely negative. As a result, there has been no impact on valuation because the fall in real rates has offset the rise in inflation expectations. On the business side, the impact will depend on companies' ability to pass on price increases. For companies with pricing power and high operating leverage, a higher level of inflation is positive for profits. For others, it will be detrimental. What's important for our allocation and markets next year will be the surprise on inflation and growth. We'll have to navigate between fierce of stagflation on one side, if we have positive surprises on inflation and negative surprises on growth, and a normalization if we have, in the end, negative surprises on inflation. It will drive markets next year and our allocation on equities, bonds, and regions. If we have negative surprises on growth, then we should be positioned more defensively. If we have positive surprises on inflation, then increase our allocation to real assets, such as commodities or real estate. The fact remains that investors are not positioned today for persistently high inflation or persistently high growth. So for us, quality companies exposed to growth themes are to be favored. It's a kind of real assets, as is regional diversification towards Europe and certain emerging countries. Real assets such as commodities and real estate should do well if we continue to have positive surprises on inflation. And finally, adding yield with some decorrelations such as absolute return strategies or private equity can compensate for the role that government bonds no longer play in a diversified portfolio. After more than 10 years of negative inflation surprises, investors may naturally tend to be complacent about inflation. It's indeed difficult to anticipate a reversal of previous trends, and it is often seen in hindsight. Let's therefore look at the forces at work, some of which are conducive to more inflation. other of which are reducing it. Looking at the chart, we see upward and downward arrows that symbolize opposing forces and show the difficulty of reaching a clear-cut conclusion. Some structural drivers of inflation, such as technological innovation, will continue to point to further disinflationary pressures. However, there are important structural factors that point to potentially higher inflation in the future. One example is globalization, which may now be turning into deglobalization. This makes it more difficult for companies to manage their production and supply chain. The resulting increase in labor and logistic costs will likely be passed on to consumers over time. Another important example is climate change. Already in Europe, it has had an important impact on energy prices. We can add to this the costs related to extreme weather events, and the cost of renovating buildings are also likely to increase. One thing is certain, however, sustained higher inflation over time means at some point a price wage spiral and therefore durable greater bargaining power for workers. This should constitute a major change compared to the pre-COVID world and is far from certain.